Hello and welcome to Dental Studies Simplified. I'm Dr. Ankita Kotecha, and in today's video we will discuss root surface biomodification. Remember, we are discussing the third and the final category of root coverage techniques, that is additive treatments. Under additive treatments, in the previous video we discussed the first type of additive treatment, GTR, and today we will discuss another additive treatment, that is root surface biomodification or root biomodification. So if you have gone through or if you have watched all my previous videos on root coverage techniques, we've been discussing every technique wherein the first step is root preparation, that is root planing and root biomodification. At that time we discussed root biomodification very briefly. So now we are in the position to discuss just root surface biomodification. What is this root surface biomodification? Why to perform, how to perform, and with what all agents are available with which we can perform. So today in this video we will discuss just root surface biomodification from root coverage perspective. Why to perform root surface biomodification in root coverage procedures particularly. We will discuss it overall in general with a little context to why particularly in root coverage techniques, because remember, root surface biomodification is not performed mandatorily in every periodontal surgical procedures. It is indicated or advisable to perform root surface biomodification in certain selective periodontal surgical procedures. One of them is periodontal plastic and aesthetic surgeries, that is root coverage. So why, how, and with what all available agents. So beginning with the first question, why to perform root surface biomodification, that is the rationale behind using root surface biomodification agents. So if you remember the mechanism of periodontal disease, so mainly periodontal disease, although multifactorial, it is mainly caused by bacteria, the primary etiology. Okay, just a rough brief explanation of why to perform root surface biomodification. So without elaborating on other factors, we will just focus on our flowchart, which will lead us to the answer of why to perform root surface biomodification. So the main etiology, primary etiology, is bacteria, although multifactorial. And what multifactorial, out of those multifactorial etiology, the main factor bacteria, what it does, it causes disease by multiple mechanisms. One of them is production of endotoxins. Okay, now with regards to endotoxins, it will reside or it will accumulate in various sites, various tissues. One of them is cementum. So here we get cementum bound endotoxin. And this is the toughest area. This is the area from where endotoxins cannot be eliminated completely. I repeat, cannot be eliminated completely. It can be, but not completely. Although in vitro, it has been shown that total removal of endotoxin is possible, which leads to or which results into new tissue formation, cell proliferation. But practically, imagine if we go behind removing these endotoxins which are bound in the cementum, and in the due course we will end up removing all the cementum and expose the dentin and cause sensitivity. So that's totally impractical. It's highly not advisable. Clear? So yes, this cementum bound endotoxin, this is the reason why we perform root surface biomodification. So now how it works? What these agents do, they demineralize this infected cementum and opens the dentinal tubules, exposes the collagen, thereby enhancing the linkage and results in the more successful treatment outcomes. But conversely, if we don't perform root surface biomodification and if we try to remove the endotoxins manually, thinking that we will remove all the cementum bound endotoxin, imagine, first of all, we will remove major part of the cementum, leading to sensitivity. Secondly, certain amount of endotoxins will be left behind. That is, traces of endotoxins are always found after the phase one therapy is completed, that is with root planing. So what that traces or left behind endotoxins does, they hinder with the treatment outcomes, they hinder with the cell proliferation, they hinder with the new tissue formation, that is a new attachment or regeneration, and thereby they impair or they reduce the degree of the success of the treatment outcomes. Some or the other amount of attachment or regeneration will take place, but the results are better or enhanced with root surface biomodification. So if we don't perform, there will be a hindrance, there will be a flowchart which will show hindrance. But if we perform root surface biomodification, these endotoxins are eliminated to a more greater degree, because it will demineralize this infected cementum and expose the dentinal tubules, expose collagen bundles, which will lead to enhanced linkage and connection. So that is why root surface biomodification has to be performed. This is all about the rationale behind using root surface biomodification, the answer to the question why. Now we will discuss, first we will discuss what all agents are available with us to perform root surface biomodification. Before discussing the agents, a brief outline of how these agents are going to be discussed. Two main parameters associated with the agents are very important. One is the pH or the concentration, and second is the duration of application. Rest all, that is rationale or the mechanism of action, advantages, disadvantages, all these will be highly overlapping between the various agents that we are going to discuss. But the only difference will be in their pH or concentration, and number two, the duration of application. This is what decides its clinical applicability, the ease of using it clinically, and that is how we decide, we choose which agents to be used. Overall, all the agents will give the same results, with certain agents advantages over the others. Now, which are they and how are they, we will discuss as and when we come on to that particular agent. So first and the foremost agent that we will discuss is citric acid. Now, the name itself says acid. Why to use an acid? Because, yes, the rationale behind using citric acid is based upon or built upon a historical perspective wherein acids were used to cleanse the root surfaces. I know, very radical, but yes, so from some point we begin to advance. Every advancement has its roots in the history. So please don't get disappointed, or don't loosen your interest in this topic. Please hold on. We will come on to better alternatives which are practical and clinically usable also. But every advancement, as I already said, has its roots in its history. So same is the case with citric acid. So citric acid was the first, foremost, I wouldn't say first, but yeah, one of the first agents to be used in root surface biomodification, because its rationale is built upon the historical usage of acid. So that is why citric acid. So as I have already mentioned, every agent will have two main parameters, two numerals to be remembered. One is the pH. So the pH or concentration, whichever mentioned for that particular agent. So for citric acid, the pH mentioned is 1.0, and the duration of application is 2 to 3 minutes. Remember, 2 to 3 minutes. So a citric acid agent of pH 1 and duration of application is 2 to 3 minutes. Now I know you must be wondering, pH 1, that is very, very low, that is highly acidic. Yes, that's the drawback of this agent, and that is why we come up with newer alternatives, advanced agents, which will overcome or rectify the drawbacks associated with the previously introduced or proposed agents. Okay, so remember the two main parameters with citric acid: pH 1, 2 to 3 minutes, duration of application, highly acidic. We know that now. So now we know that it's highly acidic. Now we will discuss the rationale, the mechanism of action, why citric acid. So earlier it was thought It demineralizes. Of course, it will demineralize. Look at its pH. We all know it is definitely going to demineralize. Not only demineralize, it will also detoxify the entire root and it will also decompose or dissolve the collagen. So forget about exposing the collagen bundles. This pH is going to end up dissolving the collagen also. So that is the drawback associated with citric acid. Dissolution also. Although it detoxifies and demineralizes the root surface and ends up exposing the collagen bundles, but sometimes it also leads to dissolution of the collagen bundles. And look at the pH, it will also lead to tissue necrosis. It will necrose the surrounding tissues, you know, the collateral damage. So yes, it will lead to that. So these are the few drawbacks associated with citric acid. You must be wondering, madam did not tell us the advantages. She is first of all listing the disadvantages. But hold on, because we have to highlight the points which, on the basis of which we are going to discuss the next stage. And that is why I am just building the foundation for the next floor to climb. That is the next agent to discuss. So we are done with the drawbacks associated with citric acid, but yes, the advantages which are common to all the agents are also with citric acid. That is demineralization of the root surface, detoxification, root detoxification. So earlier it was supposed to be just demineralization, which enhances the cementogenesis and linkage. But then when the scanning electron microscopy studies were out, when they compared only SRP and SRP with citric acid, they found SRP caused creation of a smear layer. Of course, smear layer composed of just residual debris. That residual debris smear layer was washed off by citric acid, that is SRP and combination of citric acid. When citric acid was applied after SRP, that smear layer was washed off, the root surface was demineralized, and it led to exposure of collagen. So then it was understood by scanning electron microscopy that it is not just demineralization of the root surface, which was thought to be earlier, but the next result after demineralization, what is exposed, that is exposed collagen, that is what leads to the enhancement of the treatment outcomes, because the exposed collagen onto the root surface, and remember we have collagen onto the flap under surface or the graft material as in case with the root coverage techniques. So the both the collagens on both the parts, that is on the root surface part which are exposed by the biomodification, and that are present onto the flap under surface or the graft under surface, they both are linked. That linkage is enhanced by this way, and that linkage is enhanced further by factor 13, plasma fibronectin. Fibronectin leads to the linkage, and that is how both the collagen links and leads to the new attachment and regeneration. So this is the rationale behind using citric acid. Although it has advantages, but we have already discussed and focused on the disadvantages, and that is why we will be discussing the next agent, that is tetracycline. Again, for tetracycline, it is also acidic, very low pH, although an accurate value cannot be mentioned here because it's not mentioned in any of the textbooks that I went through, but low pH, somewhat 1.8, somewhere I read 1.6, but yes, definitely very low pH, similar to that of citric acid. So highly acidic. And then the second drawback with tetracycline, although this factor is favorable here, 2 to 3 minutes is fine, but here the duration of application is almost 5 minutes, 5 minutes and sometimes more. Clear? And another drawback with tetracycline, it is dose dependent. That is, it has to reach a certain concentration, certain dosage value, below which it will not work. Here that dosage is more than 100 milligram per ml. So let's say it is 500 milligram per 5 ml. Very high dose. Okay. So this is the third drawback. The advantage is the mechanism is similar to that with citric acid. That is again root demineralization, detoxification, exposure of the collagen bundles, etc. And plus it has advantages over citric acid. So I will just write up here, tetracycline better than citric acid. Why? Remember tetracyclines. So we have already discussed host modulation agents and local drug delivery agents, periostat. So there we have discussed the properties of tetracycline family, that is anti-collagenase activity. It prevents the breakdown of collagen. Anti-collagenase activity and antibacterial activity, substantivity. So substantial antibacterial activity, somewhat of 2 to 14 days. So these are the added advantages over citric acid. The two added advantages, additional advantages in addition to the already existing advantages which are common to both citric acid and tetracycline. Tetracycline has an upper hand in terms of these two properties, anticollagenase and the substantivity of its antibacterial activity. The antibacterial activity is lasting from 2 to 14 days. So once applied, the results, the activity is workable, or it's in working condition for 2 to 14 days. So these are the two advantages in addition to those that are common to both of them. Okay, although it has the drawbacks which are also similar to citric acid, and plus an added drawback, that is dose dependent condition, a high dose required. Okay, so this is all about tetracycline and citric acid, the two highly acidic agents. So that is one major drawback common to both the agents, and that is why we will be discussing our third agent, that is EDTA. So with EDTA, the main drawback associated with these two agents, that is highly acidic pH, is rectified first and foremost. So talking about EDTA, the pH is first of all neutral, 7. Clear? The concentration is 24% and the duration of application is very minimal, only 2 minutes or so. So that is why EDTA is found to be the best of all. Best of all that we have discussed till now, okay? EDTA, because the first and the foremost advantage, neutral pH. So no or minimum tissue necrosis. I don't find any cases of tissue necrosis with the use of EDTA owing to its neutral pH. So less chances of tissue necrosis, less dissolution of collagen as in case with those acidic agents. But and other advantages in addition to those that are common to those acidic agents, we have increased exposure or greater exposure. Although citric acid and tetracycline led to exposure of collagen, EDTA causes greater exposure of collagen, greater enhancement and linkage, greater proliferation, everything more than them. And mainly the main advantage is its neutral pH, so less tissue necrosis and less dissolution of collagen fibers or bundles. And that is why EDTA produces the most biocompatible root surface, which is conducive to linkage and enhanced treatment outcomes in all the aspects. No major disadvantages or drawbacks associated with EDTA. It is favorable in terms of its pH, concentration, duration of application, that is 2 minutes is not too long compared to what is with tetracycline, that is 5 minutes or so. And everything is more, the degree of the action, the degree of the advantages are more with EDTA. So the best of the all the materials that we have discussed till now. And now we will discuss the last final agent, fibronectin. Fibronectin is actually naturally available in the body itself, that is factor 13 plasma fibronectin. Whenever root surface biomodification is done, blood clot is present and fibronectin is invariably present, which actually enhances the linkage between the exposed collagen onto the root surface and the collagen present onto the flap surface, be it the graft under surface or the flap under surface. So fibronectin is invariably present, but even if it is applied in addition to these agents, the results are bound to enhance because it has such properties. It promotes cell proliferation from the periodontal ligament. It acts as chemotactic agent for those mesenchymal cells. So ultimately resulting into regeneration or new attachment at least. Okay, so this is about fibronectin, high molecular weight glycoprotein, and the concentration with fibronectin is 0.38 per ml of saline. This is the concentration. So the concentration is also quite favorable. Now that we have discussed the four main agents in root surface biomodification, that is two acidic agents, citric acid and tetracyclines, and two better agents than those, that is EDTA and fibronectin. Now we will discuss our last and the final question, the final part of today's video. How to perform? We have already discussed why to perform, with what all agents to perform. Now we will discuss the final and the main clinical question, how to perform. So regarding how to perform, the first step is scaling and root planing. So scaling to remove the calculus and other tooth debris, root planing to remove the infected cementum within our limits. Don't be so radical and don't be too harsh on it. We have root surface agents to do its job. So do how much ever is possible with your instrumentation. Don't be behind the cementum. Don't trouble the cementum too much. It's already going to have trouble with root surface biomodification agents, especially if we use acidic agents. So remove the cementum as much as possible with our instrumentation. Clear? So the first step before doing root surface biomodification is scaling and root planing to remove calculus and cementum respectively. And then the next step is root surface biomodification. Under root surface biomodification, we have one more question. When to perform? We are not talking about the indications. The indications are, of course, first and foremost for our context is root coverage techniques, that is periodontal plastic and aesthetic surgery. Root surface biomodification can also be performed during bone regeneration, that is during treatment of intrabony defects. So that is why we have this question, when to perform. Of course, after SRP, but after SRP also, we have multiple steps of root coverage or multiple steps in performing bone regeneration. So in those steps, where does root surface biomodification stand? So for root coverage, we have already discussed the first and the foremost is root preparation, that is root planing and root surface biomodification. So the answer is, for root coverage, it is prior to beginning of the treatment, that is before giving our incisions and flap preparation and flap reflection, we have to do it prior to giving incisions and the flap preparation and reflection. Okay, so for root coverage, but as we have already discussed, it can be also used for intrabony defect, that is bone regeneration. Here the steps are, of course, the bone regeneration. So the bone walls have to be accessed, the wall of the root that covers, that faces the defect, and the walls present of the defect. So how do you think we will access those walls without reflecting, without incisions and reflecting the flap? So in this case, root surface biomodification is performed in the middle of the treatment or the surgery. That is, first we give the incisions, we reflect the flap, we perform the defect debridement, and once all the walls that forms the defect, that is the wall of the root surface, the walls, the bony walls, all the walls that altogether creates, that forms that defect, are visible, are accessible, then we have to perform root surface biomodification. So this is the answer. I hope this is very clear. In case with root coverage, it is usually performed prior to the beginning of the treatment, and in the intrabony defect or the regeneration treatment, it is performed in the middle of the surgery or the treatment. Why? We have already discussed. I hope this point is very clear to you all. Okay. And now comes the main part of how to perform. That is, once the root planing is done, now take a cotton pledget. Citric acid, EDTA, they will be used for a couple of minutes. They are liquid. Take few drops on the cotton pledget and apply it onto the, like if it, this is the root. Take this cotton pledget onto the, with the help of the tweezer or any sterile instrument, put few drops of the agent and dab here. This agent is dabbed here for 2 to 3 minutes all over the denuded root surface, or in case with the defects, all the walls of the defect, for 2 to 3 minutes, as already discussed with the individual agents. Citric acid and EDTA for 2 to 3 minutes, whereas tetracycline will be a paste form which is applied again with cotton pledget for 5 minutes. The duration of application with tetracycline is little higher, that is 5 minutes or so. So for citric acid or EDTA, 2 minutes. For tetracycline paste, 5 minutes. Okay. And then the root surface after 2 minutes or 5 minutes, whichever agent applied for root biomodification, then the root surface is irrigated profusely with saline for a couple of minutes again. Okay, this is how the root surface biomodification is performed, and then voila, the root is ready for root coverage, or the defect walls are ready to accept the regenerative material and the membrane if used along with. Okay, so for our today's video, for our context, root coverage, once this root preparation is completed, then we begin giving our incisions and the flap preparation. And once the flap is placed over the root, or the graft is placed over this root biomodified root, then the linkage is enhanced, because the ultimate mechanism of all the agents is exposure of the collagen, exposure of the dentinal tubules, collagen fibrils, you call it collagen bundles, and it will enhance the linkage. So this is how root surface biomodification is done. I hope this concept is clear to you all, and I really hope this topic, this chapter, periodontal plastic and aesthetic surgery, is getting easy for all of you. But if you still find it difficult, if you still have any doubts or any queries, feel free to ask me as many you want to as possible in the comment section below, on my Facebook, Messenger, Instagram, and I will definitely reply to all your queries on all the social media platforms available. And you can also mail your queries at my email ID dentalstudiesimplified@gmail.com. I will also remind you once again that I will discuss all the requested topics in detail thoroughly once this topic, this chapter is completed. So please be patient, please keep studying with me. I hope everything is easy for you. Study well, have a good day, stay safe.